Praise the Lord, everybody. If y'all will stand with me, and let's just go ahead and open with a sound of praise to our Lord this morning. Come on, let's give him some hand claps. Let's give him some worship. Let's give him some praise this morning. Hallelujah. I know it's a cold morning, right? We just jumped right from summer into winter this weekend. It was 70 degrees, and now there's snow on the ground. But the Lord is good no matter what. The Lord is faithful no matter what. I'm so excited for what he wants to do in this service, both of our services today, ready for revival, ready for him to pour out his spirit. Amen? Do you agree with me? So let's pray. Let's make ourselves available for him, that he would come in and we would be willing to receive it and respond to what he wants to do this morning. Amen? Join me in prayer to open our service this morning. God, we give you glory and praise, for you are so worthy of everything that we have to offer, Lord. We are here for you. We are here because of you, Lord. You created us. You created this church, Lord. And this service is yours. This people is yours. This congregation is yours, Lord. Have your way in our services this morning and this evening, God. Oh, let your spirit fall. Let your fire fall within this building, God. Every person that comes in that is listening, Lord, that they would be touched by you. They would know you. They would experience you this morning, God.
Glorify you.
There is no other
God like you. Come on, let's give that unto the Lord this morning. He is great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. 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 What a mighty God we serve. Amen. If you're able to stand, we're going to ask that you stand. We go before the Lord in prayer this morning. Amen. What a presence of the Lord in this place. So thankful for all our visitors that are here this morning joining us. Amen. Excited for our evangelist that's here, Brother and Sister Shaw, that are here with us this morning. Excited about what God wants to do here. Amen. God is so good. Amen. We need to, we're going to be apostolic this morning. Amen. We're in an apostolic church. Presence of the Lord is here. The elders are here. There's some sick folk here, some hurting folk here. Amen. Sister Hideball is facing surgery. Amen. Not sure the date, but Sister Hideball, I'm going to ask you to come up. We're going to anoint. We're going to pray. Sister Clark here, Tiffany Clark here. Amen. She has a friend, Jessica, who they have found a large mask and she needs a healing. Amen. We're going to lift her up today in prayer. Amen. Knowing that our Lord is a healer. Amen. It's by his stripes we are healed. Amen. Catherine McKinney, the niece of Sister Kim Lees, is in need of a kidney donor. Amen. Pray for that situation. Charles and Jennifer Spencer need a healing touch as well this morning. Alex Joseph, he was unable to be here this morning, a little underneath the weather. I guess there's a cold. I think it's got most of us by now with our throats and cold symptoms. Not COVID, but it's cold symptoms. Sister Murray, you got a prayer request. Kayleen's family, and your ears. Amen. The ears are no fun. I know that firsthand. Amen. We know God is able. Any got a prayer request, sister? Amen. Brother has leukemia, needs saving, and needs a healing. Amen. Sister Fran. Sister Fran's daughter needs prayer bad. So we know the Lord is able. Ain't nothing our God can't do. You need prayer for your body. We'll ask you to come up. Amen. Need prayer. We're going to be apostolic this morning. Amen. We're in an apostolic church. We believe in the power of prayer and healing. Amen. If you're unable to come up here, we'll come to you. Amen. God is good. Let's lift up our hands right now. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We're calling upon that name which is above every name, Lord Jesus. Knowing that the very mentioning of your name, Lord Jesus, you have all power and authority over all things, Jesus, by the very mentioning of your name. Touch, move, minister, Lord. Let your virtue flow, Lord Jesus. From the tops of our head to the soles of their feet, Lord Jesus. You go into that place, Lord, where they're at, Lord Jesus. And you touch and you move and you minister, Lord. Yes, Lord, tearing down every stronghold, Lord. Casting down every imagination. Lord, let that virtue flow, Lord. Provide where their provision is needed, Lord Jesus. Touch and strengthen, lead and guide, Lord. You hold all power and authority, Lord. We stand upon your word that by your stripes you are healed, Lord. As we pray this prayer of faith, Lord, casting all our cares at your feet, Lord, knowing that you're able, Lord, to do exceedingly upon the ball that we can ask and even think, Lord Jesus. According to the power that worketh within us, Lord Jesus. You are the way, Lord. You are the truth. You are the life, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord, move in a mighty way, Lord. Touch each and every visitor, Lord. Touch, Jesus, every prodigal, Lord Jesus. Let your voice and let your presence go forth, Lord, and touch and move and minister right now, Lord Jesus. As we give ourselves to you, Lord, as we humble ourselves, Lord, in demonstration of our faith in you as a healer, as a way maker, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord, we give you honor. We give you glory, Lord. Yes, Lord, it's all about you, Lord. It's not about us, Lord. Help us to decrease, Lord, that you can increase, Lord. Send it on down. Send it on down, Lord. Let the Holy Ghost fire fall upon this place. Amen. And in Jesus' name. And let everybody say in Jesus' name, amen. Smile at your neighbors. You're being seated. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. A few quick announcements. Fall Revival is here, brothers. Shaw and his family are here to minister. Amen. We have another service tonight at 6:30. Amen. Come back, invite somebody for that service as well. Wednesday night will be Kids Power Hour and Bible study here at 7. Saturday at 6 p.m., marriage giving will be here at the church basement. Please sign up in the vestibule. All married couples that plan on attending, please sign up. Hyphen's friend Griffin will be Saturday also at 5 at the home of Sister Danielle. And next Sunday at 6:30 p.m., we'll have another special speaker in Brother Holly. Amen. God is good. Amen. Revival. Amen. We're in revival. Amen. Lord is tearing down strongholds. He's moving in mighty ways. Amen. Before our ushers come, Friday was Veterans Day. Amen. And you know, we have several veterans in here. I probably embarrass people about prayer there. Sorry about that. But if you're a veteran, can you stand? Amen. You know, Brother Corky, Brother Blackford. Amen. Just want to say thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your service to this nation. Brother Jones, yes, Brother Jones as well. Amen. Unable to stand. Amen. But God is good. Brother France, amen. The list goes on and on. Seen a man with a jacket yesterday. Said some gave all. All gave some, but some gave all. Your sacrifice matters. Your sacrifice made a difference. Amen. And it's like our sacrifices make a difference in the kingdom of God. Amen. As we're preparing to worship Him in our giving. Lord, we love and we praise you, Lord, and thank you for all that you do, Jesus. And bless each and every giver. Allow it to multiply for the furthering of your kingdom. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, Thank you. All across this place and love Jesus this morning. Come on, unto God be the glory forever. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. You know, it's one thing to say, not my will, but His will. And it's another thing to live, not my will, but His will. And I want to live a lifestyle that says, not my will be done, but Your will be done. Amen? Amen. The presence of the Lord is in this place this morning. We're so excited that you've come. For those visiting, we want to welcome you one more time. We hope you like what you feel. If you think it feels good in here, it's not because it's nice and warm. It's because the presence of the Lord is in this place. Amen. Amen. So we're delighted for our fall revival this year to have the Shaw family with us all the way from Ontario, Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. And so we had the opportunity to spend time with Brother and Sister Shaw and their son Judah yesterday, and it was just such a wonderful time. And he preaches all over the world. He hosts one of the biggest podcasts for apostolics. But most importantly, Brother Adam Shaw is a Christian. And we love him already. And we're excited. Why don't we give him a Middletown, Ohio welcome as he comes to preach the word this morning.
Why don't you turn that to Jesus? The presence of the Lord is so strong in this room. Come on, lift your hands with me, lift your voice with me, and begin to call out to Jesus. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's just put your hands together. Let's magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt His name together. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. My Jesus, my Jesus, my Jesus, my Jesus, we love you. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Turn with me in your Bibles to Job chapter 9. Feels good to be in church this morning, doesn't it? Thank you so much, Pastor, for the honor and privilege of letting me come here. Your hospitality of both yourself, your wife, this team has been incredible. I was telling, I don't know, they call you Brother Himes or Tyler or Brother Tyler. I was immediately blown away when we walked into our hotel room and I found in the gift basket there was stuff for my son. And so I I really appreciate that. You know, we were talking in the office. You know what it means to be a PK, and thank you for recognizing. We had a great time with the Himes and Madison last night. We had a great time, as well as and it was awesome. We had a wonderful experience, and you know what? I'm really bad at this preamble stuff. I'm more of like, I just kind of preach. So is that okay? I love you. Hopefully you'll like me at the end. If not, I'm sure I'll be all right. But we all love the Lord. We're happy to be here. The weather's not great. It's nice in here. Okay, we all got that over with? All right, wonderful. All right, Job chapter 9. And we're going to read verses 1 through 2 and then 10 through 16. It's so good to have my wife here with me. And I don't get a chance to travel much with her, but we were able to drive here. So that was fantastic. And then Job answered and said, verse 1 of Job 9, "Truly I know it is so. But how can a man be righteous before God? If one wished to contend with him, he could not answer him one time out of 1,000. He does great things past finding out. Yes, wonders without number. If he goes by me, I don't see him. If he moves past, I do not perceive him. If he takes away, who can hinder him? Who can say to him, what are you doing? God will not withdraw his anger. The allies of the proud lie prostrate beneath him. How then can I answer him and choose my words to reason with him? For though I were righteous, even if I could be righteous," which is, the implication is I'm not, "I could not answer him. I would beg mercy of my judge. If I called and he answered me, I would not believe that he was even listening to my voice." With the help of the Lord and that happy scripture, I want to preach to you on this subject, the void between God and me. Let's pray. Jesus, you're here. Jesus, at the end of this sermon, Lord, you're going to release the gift of healing in this room. God, accept the sign, Lord, of healing that will take place in this room will not be empty wheelchairs. God, abandoned on the altar on the platform, but Lord Jesus, it's going to be people restored and renewed in their minds. It's going to be people, Lord Jesus, that 5 years from now or 10 years from now, Lord, they're going to be better. They're going to be healthy. They're going to have a vibrant relationship with you. They're going to be living in their purpose, God. So right now, at the very beginning of this message, we declare by faith that, Lord, you're about to move in this house. You're about to open up the windows of heaven. The gifts of your spirit, God, are about to be in operation in your body. And Lord, we are all going to leave here transformed because, God, we're going to respond by faith to the preaching that's in your word. So I pray, bless the rest of this service, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. And if you believe that God's going to move, I want you to clap your hands to him and give him praise. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated. Job has, he suffered just about as much as anybody in Scripture. He's lost everything. He's gone. His money's gone. He's in financial ruin. His businesses are gone. His family is gone. It's all been ripped from him suddenly and violently. Have you ever stopped and considered what it would have been like to have been Job? I mean, we read Job, but we don't really read Job. You know what I mean? Like, we read all the other stories of people in the Bible. We you know, we read, okay, his life fell apart and then God restored everything. And, or, you know, David saw Goliath and then he went out, and we skip right over to the good part, but we sometimes forget that for these people in the scripture, I mean, this was their real life. I mean, this was, they were living this. They never had the ability to be like, well, this story is a little sad. Let's jump to the end and figure out how it got resolved. They never get an opportunity to do that. This is their life. And have you ever stopped and considered what it would have been like to have been Job? First, he's lost his business, right? Theft and natural disaster take everything that he's ever built. And he's annihilated it in a matter of moments. His servants are gone. People that, yes, they're called servants, but we read in the scripture that Job was a good, he was a righteous man. It was his job to take care of these people and their families and their children. And they have now been trampled, murdered, stabbed, beaten to death by bandits. People that he has employed for years. People to whom he owes his success. He's been tasked with feeding their families, and now he is standing at the doorstep of their little homes trying to explain to kids and moms why dad or big brother or uncle is not coming home anymore. And then the ultimate wound is kids. The trauma of pulling a house collapses upon his family. In Job's day, there were no first responders to come and cordon off the neighborhood with police tapes so that he wouldn't see the awful bits, that he would see maybe the bodies of his children after the funeral home and clean them up. No, that was not. Job was the first responder. And whatever servants had not died at the hands of bandits, they were the ones that were peeling back the rubble. His children had been crushed and blown apart by the collapsing of the being crushed is not a peaceful death. Job experiences a lifetime of trauma compressed into a very short period of time. And now he sits in the ruins of his life with no money and no health, scraping infection from his boils. His head spinning. And what's happening to me? Is this real life? God, where are you? Why have you let this happen? As he sits in shock, the world's worst friends come over. As his grief is giving away to like that deep sadness that you feel in your bones when there's no more tears left, the worst friends in the world come over. And they come up the driveway, and the moment they see him, they burst into tears and they cry for 3 days. I mean, I understand they're grieving, they're mourning. It's a culture I don't really. But bro, like if I'm ever sick and you come and you see me in the hospital, and the first thing you do is you sit on the floor and you don't say a word and you just cry for 3 days. I'm gonna feel really bad about how I look. Like it's just... So they grieve with him and they cry and they mourn. But then when that is over, one by one. And Job is poetry, and so someone maybe busts out a guitar. And after weeping and grieving, they begin to poetically judge him and accuse him and imagine what he must have done wrong to deserve the pain that has come into his life. And this brings us to our text. Job is responding. He's overwhelmed by the accusations. He has been punched down by life, and now he has been stepped on by his friends. He says in verse 9, Truly, chapter 9, verse 1, I know it is so, but how can a man be righteous before God? If one wished to contend with him, he cannot answer him one time out of 1,000. Who can debate God? Who can stand in the presence of God? Who can make... I know what you've said about me. I don't believe it's true, but who in their right mind can stand before God? He does in verse 10. He does great things past finding out. Wonders without number. If he goes by me, I don't see him. If he moves past, I don't perceive him if he takes away. If God wants to come in my life and rip stuff out, how can I stop him? Who can say to God, what are you doing? God will not withdraw his anger. The allies of the proud, and proud doesn't mean puffed up. Proud doesn't mean conceited. Proud doesn't mean that your ego is so large. Proud means strong. Proud means capable. Proud means you got it all together. And Job's saying, if the allies of the people that got it all together, if the strong, if the most spiritual, if the most perfect, the people that got everything all together in their life, if they cannot but lie before him, how in the world can I even defend myself? How then can I answer him and choose my words to reason with him? For though I were righteous, I could not answer him. I could just beg mercy. If I called, and this is the sad part, if I called and he answered me, I couldn't even believe it was him. Job turns after he's been accused by his friends, sitting there in the front of whatever is left of his life, covered in boils. Job turns practically philosophical in front of his friends. And he in this poem, he talks about divine incomprehensibility. He said, how can a human being even know God? In the face of these accusations, he throws up his hands in despair and says, how can I even know God? In short, he is saying, there is a void. There is a void between God and me. A vast, dark, empty space separates us. God is so large. He is the creator of the universe. His movements are imperceivable. If he were next to me right now, how could my puny mind even know he was there? When God is mad, only the strong can lay face down in the dirt. I am clearly fragile. Look at how I've been reduced to nothing. The void of who I am in my weakness and who he is in his greatness is an uncrossable emptiness that I cannot even begin to fathom. Other parts in the chapter, Job describes God as an omnipotent force that shakes the earth and darkens the stars and hides the sun and disappears the mountains. And then he says, in the process, God's boot is so large that when he crushes the wicked, sometimes good people like me get caught up in the collateral damage. So how can a God like this understand a guy like me? How in the world can God identify with me? See, Job's questions are not one of cognition. He's not saying God can't use Google and find my house. He's not saying that God doesn't know where I live. These are not questions of cognition, but they're questions of empathy. I mean, he knows me, but does he know what it is like to be me? God can't get tired. God can't get sick. God can't get crushed by life. God's never beaten down by natural disasters. God has never been, he has never been weak. So how in the world can he identify with me? And if we're honest today, Job's questions are our questions. Job's cry is our cry. You may not have lost your kids to an earthquake, but you've lost your family to the world. You may not have pulled your children out of actual rubble of a fallen down house, but they're trapped under the rubble of things like addictions and sin. Maybe you've lost somebody to sickness. Maybe bandits haven't stolen your sheep, but the pandemic or inflation has robbed you of your job and your career. And like Job, the losses you have suffered. Yes, you come to church. You know how to say amen. You know how to clap on the two and the four. You know how to raise your hands at all the right moments. And you got your good mask on. But on the inside, you're wondering, God, like, what in the world is going on with my life? Do you even see me? I know I'm here and I'm doing all the right stuff so no one judges me. But God, do you even care? Not a theology lesson as if God can't find your address or not know your zip code, but do you identify with where I'm at? Job says, if God were here, I'd tell him this, I'd tell him that. I'd tell him this, I'd tell him that, but what's the use? Because I can't even stand in his presence. let alone speak. And then his cry crescendos in Job chapter 9, 32 and 33. He says, for he is not a man as I am, that I may answer him. Nor is there any mediator between us who may lay his hand on us both. If only God were a man like me, that I could stand before him and he'd listen. If the imperceivable, all-powerful God were somehow to become a man like me, he'd know. I could make my case if only I had a mediator between me and God. One hand on heaven, another hand on earth. One hand on God, another hand on my brokenness. If there was some way someone could stand in the gap between me and God, someone could cross the chasm between us, God would see. And the dread of him would no longer terrify me. And his rod of wrath could be taken away. And I could stand in his presence. And I could speak. And I would have no fear. Well, I'm here to preach to you today. I don't know what Job knew he was saying. What Job didn't know was that as he cried out, there was a mediator that was coming. And thousands of years later, the request of Job was heard. As Paul wrote in 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Clap your hands to the Lord if you would right now. Shatanaba Satanabahaya. One God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. God as a man is the answer to Job's plea. Jesus Christ is one hand in the throne room of God and another hand on human suffering. It is one hand on the power of God and another hand on the earth. The man Christ Jesus bridged that uncrossable chasm and void by shedding his blood on the cross. The beauty of Jesus is that God has moved into the human race, and he has, in the words of Brother Bernard, permanently attached himself to the humanity that he created. See, the wonder of Jesus is that Jesus is God become a human being. God took all of his glory, God took all of his character, God took all of his personality, and it became a human being. That's why John would write, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. We reach verse 14. The Word became flesh. Literally, according to New Testament scholar N.T. Wright, the Jewish people, they believed that if you wanted to see God, you went to that big building at the top of the hill in Jerusalem. You went to the temple, and there you could see God. But really, you couldn't see God, especially if you were not Jewish like all of us. You could just peer on the outside. You could get glory adjacent, but you couldn't actually be in the glory of God. Only special people from a special family had access to the glory. And really, only one man once a year could go into the place where you could see the presence of God. But John is writing, and he is writing to believers. And he said, if you want to see the tabernacle of God's glory and his presence, you're not going to see it in a building that you can't even walk into. No, you see it in sandals, walking in the dust, touching lepers, touching adulterers, touching those who are broken and demon-possessed. The glory, the purpose of God is now tabernacled in a human body and dwelt among us, and we saw him. We beheld his glory, the glorious of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. As oneness Pentecostals, we are absolutely correct that Jesus Christ is the Almighty God. Isaiah 9 and 6 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." Before he ascended up into heaven, Jesus came and spake unto them, saying in verse 18 of Matthew 28, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Jesus is the Almighty God. He has all power. He has all authority. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. Demons tremble at his name. Sickness flees at his name. There is no name that is higher than the name of Jesus. One day every devil in hell will have to bow its knee. But as we celebrate the divinity of Jesus, we cannot neglect the humanity of Jesus. Incarnated in flesh means human identity, not just a human body. Jesus is more than God with human clothes on. He is God personified as a human person. What makes you a human being is more than just your body. You've got a mind, you've got a soul, you've got a will, you've got all these emotions. And if Jesus would ever take your place, if he ever bear your sin and take your punishment and your brokenness, he had to be completely human. Jesus did not have a separate human identity from God. But as Brother Bernard says, humanity and deity were united together in his spirit. He was both human and divine. That's why Hebrews would write, being the brightness of his glory, speaking about the man Christ Jesus, the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. Jesus is God expressed in flesh. God took all that he is, his will, his mind, his emotions, and incarnated it into a human person. The beauty of Jesus and the beauty of this incarnation is not that God looked like a man in Christ Jesus. Not that God appeared to be a man in Christ Jesus. But that God became a man just like you, yet without sin. Jesus Christ, here's where the rubber meets the road on our Sunday morning worship together. Jesus Christ is the answer to Job's cry. Only, if only God were a man like me, I could stand before him face to face. Well, Job, God has become a man just like you. That's why John would write, "We beheld his glory." Jesus was human like you, yet without sin. Jesus needed to pray. He didn't just pray because it was a good example, but he had to deal with people all day. And sometimes they were too much. He had to get onto a boat only to be woken up by his disciples who were afraid because he was in the boat and they thought they were all going to drown. He had to go into a mountain to get away from them because he was wore out. See, Jesus is the empathy of God on display. Maybe I got my definitions wrong, but let me explain it like this. Sympathy is like, I feel bad. I see people that are broken. I feel sympathetic. My heart is moved. I, from my position of privilege, I look down upon those that are beneath my status of life, and I feel bad. I feel sympathetic towards you. But empathy says, I'm not just going to sit from afar off and I'm going to feel bad about where you're at. Empathy says, I'm going to leave where I am and I'm going to come to where you are, and I'm going to put my arm around you and I'm going to walk a mile in your shoes. I'm going to put myself in your place. I'm going to figure out what it's like to be you. Remember the cry of Job? I want you to listen to the cry of a Messiah in Psalm 22 as David looks forward in future and sees Jesus. He pens the words of our Savior on the cross. And Psalm 22, my God. This is Jesus. This is the Lord. My God. My God. Why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words? Remember, Job said, I cry out in the daytime. I look around. I can't see you. I can't perceive you. Here is God in flesh on the cross saying, I cry in the daytime. You don't hear. And the night season and am not silent. But you are holy. You're enthroned in the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in you. They trusted in you and deliver them. They cried to you and deliver them. They trusted in you and were not ashamed. Other people got their prayers answered. What about me? Have you ever prayed that? Have you ever come to church and you heard the testimonies of miracles and deliverance and wonder and heard the stories of how God broke through and how God worked a miracle, and you're sitting in the pew and you got your smile on your face? You're like, oh, that's so great. But inside your heart is screaming, what about me? Jesus is on the cross and saying, you help them. What about me? They trusted in you and you delivered them, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. All those who see me ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake their heads, said, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. If you really are the Christ, come down from that cross. If you really are the Christ, won't you call legions of angels to come rescue you? Let him deliver him since he delights in him. But I'm poured out like water. My heart is like wax. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. You have brought me near the dust of death. See, Jesus, I'm reading this psalm because Jesus is the answer. We're going to minister in the Holy Ghost in just a moment. But Jesus is the answer of prayer. For everyone who knows that they need God but feel like he's too far away. He is the answer of everyone that feels like they're lost in secret sin. But the holiness of God is like an unapproachable light that does not even comprehend what it's like to struggle with that addiction or to struggle with that pain or to struggle with the memory of that failure. Well, Jesus knows what it is like to be you. The one who neither slumbers nor sleeps falls exhausted in a boat. The one whose glory is so profound that angels cover their faces accepts the kiss of his betrayer. Jesus knows what it is like to grieve the loss of friends, the loss of people that should have been there for you. The people that should have stuck by you in your darkest moments, they fled because they looked and they felt too awkward to be around your pain. They averted their eyes to the shame that you were experiencing in your life. And you wondered, God, do you see me? Jesus sees you. He was abandoned by those closest to him too. Do you live what feels like a sign of shame because of the family you come from? The language you speak, the nation of origin you're from, the ethnicity that you have. People said bad things about you. Well, people said about Jesus. They said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Or maybe you grew up like my parents who grew up in abject poverty. And you wonder, God, do you know what it's like to be stretched thin? God, you own everything. Do you know what it's like to be without? Well, the one who owns a cattle on a thousand hills looked around to his followers and said, foxes have holes, birds have nests. Does anyone know where I can sleep tonight? The one with no beginning and no ending took your stripes on his back and felt your pain. Jesus suffered so much that Isaiah would write, he is despised and rejected of man, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he's borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken. We said God judges him, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. Musicians, please come. And by his stripes, we are healed. What are you preaching this morning, Adam? You've thrown a lot of Bible verses at me. I'm preaching you a very simple thought. You never have to wonder, does God see me? Does God know me? Does God understand me? You never have to question, does God feel how I feel? Does God comprehend the hurt? Does God know how much I am in need? And as a result of serving a God like that, Hebrews chapter 4 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly before the throne of grace. That we may obtain mercy. Find some grace to help. Do you need some help? Jesus, I feel your presence. Do you need some help? Do you need some help? Did you come in this morning saying, God, I got some burdens that I'm carrying. I need some help. God, I'm embarrassed that I even feel this way. I should have more faith. God, I need some help. Because you serve a God who knows what it is like to be you. Scripture says you need mercy. You need grace. You get to come boldly. You don't have to shrink back from pouring out your heart to God. You don't have to hide who you are. You don't have to bury your struggles, your worries, your anxieties. I've said it three times. I'll say it a fourth. So many people wear a mask to church and they feel that God wants their praise but not their pain. No, no, no. You get to come boldly in the presence of God. The incarnation screams at you this morning. There's grace for you. There's blood for you. There's forgiveness for you. There's help for you. There's hope for you. There's restoration for you. You'll find grace. This is not just a sermon that I write down and I preach places. This is very real for me. I was seated at my desk a little while ago and I was extremely overwhelmed because I was hurt. I felt the claws of bitterness. It's almost like you could feel it physically. Ever been there before? Been hurt? It feels like something's trying to sink itself into your mind. And I was struggling because I didn't want to feel this way. I was at my desk to prepare a sermon because I'm a preacher. And here I was trying to write down notes of something to say to people. And I was not okay myself. It's hard being a human being, isn't it? I felt like Job. I'm experiencing pain, but I'm haunted that I shouldn't be plagued by this pain. And I was reading Job. Stand with me. I'm going to be done in a moment. And I was reading this. I was reading Job as part of my Bible reading. I had abandoned my sermon prep because it was pointless at that point. And I found myself in Job chapter 9. And hearing Job's cry. Only. God, if you only knew. Got to that verse where it says, if God were a man like me, immediately I felt arrested by the Holy Ghost in my basement. And I felt the Lord cry out to me, I know what it is like, Adam, to be a man like you. I was hurt by people that should not have hurt me. I was rejected by the people that should have stood next to me. I felt pain and was heartbroken by the people that should have been around me in my lowest moment. But Adam, I want you to know that I overcame. And if I overcame, you can overcome too. So come boldly. I cried, Father, forgive them. And you can cry that too. Bitterness doesn't have to control you. Regret doesn't have to consume you. Guilt doesn't have to become the filter over your mind. Somebody, that if you will come boldly, that doesn't mean you come with your praise perfect. It means you come as you truly are, without hiding, in the presence of God. You will find grace. Grace is unmerited favor. Grace is when you come to church on a Sunday and you're overwhelmed at what lays ahead and God pulls you out. Grace. When you've sinned and you've fallen short of the glory of God and the devil is in your ear and you are hearing words of guilt and shame, grace is when God lifts you out of your shame and he seats you in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Grace is when the calendar turns over and you feel the pain of that anniversary or that loss or that death and you feel so low. Grace is when you come to church and you say, Jesus, will you help me? And Jesus gives you beauty instead of ashes. He gives you joy instead of mourning. He comforts and heals your soul. Lift your hands all over this room. The Holy Ghost, Atola Boshanda, is here. He andara Boshanda Bahaya. Come on, that's it. I wonder if you would just lift your hands to Jesus at this altar. His grace to help you in your time of need. In this altar is hope to get you through in your time of need. Right here at the front of this church is an opportunity for you to step out from your seat. And as you step out of your seat, you're saying to God, I'm stepping out of the mindset that I've had about you and my pain. And I'm walking to the front because I'm coming boldly to get my hope, to get my help, to find my grace. If that's you today, if you're in need of some help, if you're in need of some hope, I encourage you to come to this altar. If you're in pain, if you're in worry, if you're depressed, if you're facing anxiety, if you're overwhelmed about tomorrow, if you've been betrayed, if you've been heartbroken, come. You can find help. That's it, as they begin to sing right now. I want you to reach out to Jesus. I want you to reach out to Jesus. Sandala bohosi andala bahaya. Hati ala bohosi andala bahaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, that's it. Reach out to him. Reach out to him. Reach out to him. Come on, you don't have to hide. No more hiding. No more putting on a good face. You're in the presence of Jesus. Come on, I'm reaching out to people that have been through some stuff. I'm reaching for people right now that you have dealt with or are dealing with infertility and you're heartbroken. God is reaching for you right now. I'm reaching for people that have experienced death and abuse and loss. God's saying, come boldly, I can help you. That's your reach out. Reach out. That's your don't be afraid. Open up your mouth and just pour out your life to Jesus. Even if you don't even know what to say, you can pray in the Holy Ghost. And God knows exactly what you mean. The Spirit of God will pray through you.
I want you to keep praying, but I feel specifically led of the Holy Ghost to reach for two groups of people. One is going to be extremely specific. I don't know you, you don't know me. No one's told me your life. Brother Tyler and I have been so deep into books, into theology and all that stuff that we have not had the time to discuss you, okay? But the Lord is reaching right now for people who feel invisible. You feel invisible. You feel like no one sees, no one knows. Maybe you feel invisible in your family. Maybe you feel invisible before God. No one sees, no one knows, and as a result, they don't care. God sees you. God, maybe you told this to a family member. Maybe you wrote it down into a journal. Maybe you posted it on an Instagram story to only your close friends. You feel invisible. God sees you. The gift of healing is in this room. And the sign that you're going to be healed is not going to be a CT scan or a doctor's report, but it's going to be 10 years from now and you still serve the Lord and you have purpose for your life and you're walking in the anointing of the Lord. I want to speak healing into your life and into your mind right now. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to drag you to the front. I'm not going to expose you at all. But I'm saying if that's you, I want you to reach out to Jesus right now. And this is going to be, maybe I'm off. I do not make a habit of doing this. I'm not that guy, okay? But maybe there's some people here that you've been wanting to have kids, but you can't. And there is a hollowed out part of your heart that you've been carrying into church. You feel like you should be satisfied with your life. You should be thankful. Stephanie and I know more about that pain than what you may realize. We're thankful for our boy, but we know more about that pain than what you may realize. But the Holy Ghost is speaking to you right now. I don't know your story. No one has talked like this. I've been in my car eating Chick-fil-A or hanging out. That's it. But God is reaching for you right now. You have prayed for a child and you feel like God has not heard you. I want to let you know that you are seen by God. You are heard by God. And God is close to you, and what you feel like is pain in your life. God's reaching for everyone right now, but I wonder if we could raise our hands. God right now is reaching specifically for maybe one, maybe two couples. He's also reaching for people that feel invisible. He's letting you know that he sees you. I want you to raise your hand right now by the authority of the Word of God and by the blood that was shed on Calvary. I speak divine healing. Lord, we pray for the legs to be restored and the backs to be healed. And I have seen all of that, Jesus. But Lord, there's something that happens when the mind gets healed. Lord, when you begin to go into the hurt areas of our spirit and you begin to heal them like you remove tumors out of somebody's body. Like you rearrange the pathways in our brain. Like you rearrange the arteries that somebody's got in their heart that are blocked. I speak that healing into this room by the power of the name of Jesus. Come on, lift your hands right now. Come on, all over this room. All over this room. All over, let's respond to the Holy Ghost. Let's respond to the Holy Ghost. Let's respond right now to the Lord.